for the opportunity to share this with you. This, you may recall just from perspective, the last time we did a comprehensive campus master plan was in the mid-90s, and it resulted in the University Village, which we need to update the president's slide. I believe the tax revenue to the city off the village now is about $4.5 million a year. As I've been told, is the third highest paid tax entity in the city of Norfolk now. That plan was originally to include more retail and additional program, and the original plan was only to do $4 million total tax revenue. So without that program, we've at least achieved that contribution to the health of the city. So that partnership was really important to the future of the university. Now, the environment has changed a lot about the campus. We've moved from being a highly commuter campus to highly residential. We've become a national research university rather than just a doctoral institution. Our student engagement programs and athletic programs are much, much different than when we did the last campus master plan. So the initiative here was to take a really hard look at the university, what all of the programmatic needs were, an engaged process that allowed us to identify what is the vision for the physical development of the institution. So what I'd like to share with you today is just how we conducted that process, the data we examined, the results of it, how we actually developed the plan, the parts of the plan, and then we will put all that back together and then kind of review the results. I've been fortunate in my life to learn how to do campus master planning. And in fact, the years that I was out of higher education was professionally employed to do that. I've personally done about 12 campus master plans in my life. So doing this one was more of a pleasure because of our caring for the university. But to do that, it has to be engaged. You have to spend a lot of time talking with people, understanding the issues, before you really can start defining those solutions. This represents a portion of the engagements we had in learning and hearing from people about the institution. In fact, there were 72 different engagements where we invited people to the table to talk about the campus. We learned from that some very subjective things that are important. Things people appreciate about the campus in this category, I don't think any great surprises. Things people would like to see changed. This is not a surprise. The parking that happens in every campus master plan I've ever done, whether the problem is parking or an unwillingness to walk. In our campus, it's an unwillingness to walk.
An unwillingness to walk.
Right. So, but if I look in this category, it really starts telling us that the nature of the institution has changed. Never before in a campus master plan would you have heard people bring up the concepts of student life or student housing or recreation. And that those indicators tell you really that the nature of the institution has changed, and we have to allow those in the plan. Now, that's a pretty subjective process. There is actually a very analytical process that one uses in doing campus master planning as well, and that is to really understand how much space you have now, what is it used for, and how much do you need. To do that, the space is broken into several categories. The academic space of the institution as defined by these subcategories, what we label as academic support space, characterized here, and auxiliary space. Now, there's a huge major difference between the two first categories and the third. The first two categories are considered E&G space, and we can seek state support in building those facilities. All properties in this space category must be funded by the institution and self-supporting.
E&G.
E&G is the educational grandeur. That's the first two categories. So when people may ask you, why do they have to pay to park here on campus? The Code of the Commonwealth does not allow us to use state resources in building parking facilities. It must be self-supporting, much like your parking operation. So therefore, we must generate the revenue as an auxiliary program. So dining, housing, student or athletic, student rec, all of those things that we need to do, we must fund those capital expansions. Now in this process, we don't really measure student housing the same way, but I will talk about how we do measure student housing a little later. So I'm sure you have already read this and digested every bit that's there. The display is not really intended for you to read the detail of it, but more for me to point out a couple of interesting points. All of the space categories are identified here, and to do the assessment, one has to pick a point in time and measure the university. What's the population of students, employees, how much space do you have, and what is it used for? The first three columns here, in fact, do that. And what that tells us is when we apply state space guidelines, and it is things like, for every student, you should have 17 square feet of classroom space. It tells you how much library space you should have. For areas that do not have space guidelines with them, things like the Union, one turns to national predictors. What, at an institution of our character and size, what would you expect to find there? So we applied all of those factors to the analysis. And what it tells us is right now, what if you could read this, right now on this campus for our student population, we are about 700,000 square feet short of space in all of those categories. Now, if you look in the future about what a master plan really is about, and you take our very limited enrollment growth plan, which is only 1% a year. So as the president said, we're not about becoming bigger and bigger, we're about being better and turning out more graduates from that population. But even with that slight enrollment growth over a 20-year period, this number actually turns out to be about 1.2 million square feet that we need to add to this campus. And we have 1.6 in total now. So basically, we have to double the size of this campus. Now, when you see that, that's a daunting task and complicated. So we establish some real planning objectives about how we approach this. They are represented here. And let me point out this first bullet, because the last plan that included campus expansion was at a time when that could happen. We just do not see that possibility on the table now. So it influences the strategy of how you would build the campus, and it tells you automatically that you've got to take the campus up and that we have to do some redevelopment of the institution to bring a higher set of efficiency to the campus in the landmass that we actually have. Most of the bullets you see really represent some of those subjective issues that we heard when we talked to people, like preserving green space. For an urban institution, this campus has a very pastoral setting, and that is important to people here, and we need to try and preserve that. The final objectives are represented here, which continue those kind of thoughts about the character of the campus. So the way we did it is we broke the campus down to its parts, looked at the pieces, a lot of alternatives, and then finally kind of put it all back together and then validated the plan. So if we start by looking at what are the boundaries of this institution, because this is all we have to work with now, it is represented in this outline area here. And just a casual look at it says that we have very little developable land in the current footprint. And quite honestly, there are no large pieces of land that give you contiguous development space. So we have to craft together a plan that will fit within those parameters. So we did that by using a concept called campus precincts. And first started looking at the academic precinct of the campus, and there is kind of a naturally occurring core of the institution represented in orange here that is that academic core, where our colleges primarily exist, where the students go to take classes and labs and the like, and then several other emerging precincts, like the athletics precinct has kind of established itself in the southwest corner. We've got several housing precincts that have naturally appeared, and then a research precinct. So understanding that, we started looking further at each precinct, especially the academic core, and understanding how we could amend that to bring those space requirements. So what I'm going to share with you now are the planned additions to the campus. So if I don't mention one of your favorite buildings, that means it really nothing happens to that building. There are very few of those examples, though, I will warn you. So in the College of Arts and Letters, we need to add some space and predominantly look at what that shortfall is. In our Arts and Letters College, we just do not have a large enough venue for performances that can support the size of the performing body and or the audience. So we believe in this location, and that is currently where our College of Health Sciences is. And some of you that's been around a long time, we used to call it the Technology Building. That we will convert that site to a performing arts center. It makes sense for it to be on Hampton Boulevard as a public venue, and there's parking, as well as it complements the arts district in the village that we would have performing spaces there. We are doing the new art building that you will see this afternoon, as well as the annex. To that. And those were the primary space needs within that college. The School of Business, soon to be or currently named the Strom College of Business. That is an important move that the college has been named by someone who believes in and made a commitment to the university. Is located in Constance Hall on 49th Street. The old Visual Arts Building eventually will be demolished, and it creates building sites for us to add new structures. All of the new structures I'm describing to you are planned to be about 4 or 5 stories high so that we mass the campus up. In our opinion, if we go much higher than that, the campus is just too massive for the footprint that exists. We start creating kind of the tunnel approach to the campus. And we don't believe that creates the environment that we're interested in. In education, you know that we are beginning a new building here at the corner of 43rd and Hampton, which will take this building that they're currently located in and make it usable for other purposes. We are additionally adding a building to the Child Development Center as part of that project so that we can consolidate all of our child stuff into one location, bringing it off of 48th Street and the trailers that it's been in for a long time. And if we need to add additional space in the future for the education, The building here on Hampton Boulevard, which is old and been there for a very, very long time, would be redeveloped and taken up to add new space, as well as create appropriate massing statements of the campus along Hampton Boulevard. For engineering, it's primarily located in the Kaufman buildings now, although we have opened a new building this summer, the engineering systems building located here. This building is complete now, but we have the ability to add new space around that complex, really starting to create the academic quad concept and creating identity for our six colleges within this academic setting and really strengthening that. Health sciences, once we are through using the old education building for swing space for some of these things, it turns out that the College of Health Sciences is the only building that is located, only college located east of Hampton Boulevard. This gives us the opportunity to redevelop the old education building site and bring that college back into the academic core of the institution. Now, the sciences is very complicated and difficult. You may notice this footprint here. This is the building we are sitting in, Webb Center. And by implication, if you look at that footprint, that says this building will be demolished and rebuilt. We have to consolidate the building to create building sites for science expansion. There is just no other place to do it, considering that we have major investments in these existing buildings, along with this building, and Mills Godwin. So to actually implement the quad concept for the College of Sciences, we have to create building sites. Now, it turns out that a science building is not a program that we just can kind of temporarily locate somewhere and then move back into it. So further complicating that, we have to build a new science building to relocate chemistry and the planetarium before we can demolish that building to create the second building site. So the dominoes here are kind of Webb Center, the first science building, demolition, and the second science building, and then renovation of Mills Godwin to finally build out that quad concept for sciences. Now, one of the things that this institution has never had is kind of general academic flexible space. And we have a plan for that. In front of the Dragas International Center, there's adequate room for us again to add a building that supports this programmatic need, but also allows us to continue that massing statement of the campus on Hampton Boulevard. It's amazing to me the number of people that come here and tell me that when they drive by the campus, down Hampton Boulevard, they really didn't know they were at the campus. So we've got to make a bigger statement about here we are. This building location is a combined building that I will speak a little more detail at, but just keep in mind that it will have some flexible space in it as well. So that kind of builds out the academy and the academic needs of the institution in a very concise manner that provides and promotes efficient access and movement of students between classes and academic colleges. The research program itself is currently anchored by the two IRP buildings located in the University Village. And we have the opportunity to add an additional about 200,000 square feet of research facilities. We would propose moving those facing Hampton Boulevard so that we start creating physical identity and representation of the university beginning at 38th Street.
So David, just can I be real quick so I can better get it in my head. Mm-hmm. The area where Central Radio is.
Yes, they are planned for in here.
That, those buildings that you're showing us, the research buildings, would lie right on Hampton Boulevard. Central Radio would be behind them.
There's Central Radio right there.
So it's right on the boulevard.
I'm getting old and getting the shakes. I might have to quit using these pointers.
For some reason, I thought those were, I don't know, were going to be housing.
So we built around them.
Okay.
Okay. The old master plan, the original master plan, did have a different program here.
Okay.
But the programmatic needs of the university changed. And so we're redefining that program and putting together these pieces in some logical order now, allowing for the integrity of the three properties that we don't own within that footprint. So with that, now we've got academics and research kind of put together. So we now have to start dealing with looking at this campus community as a residential community, and what do we do with that? This kind of outlines the existing housing that's on the campus, the metrics of it that generally most highly residential research universities house between 35 and 45% of their students on campus, and that's it. No more than that. So you can see that generally is really aimed at the freshman sophomore level. So we, in those metrics, which is represented here, and we look at the loss beds we will have, because some of our residence halls are just not, they're just way out of date and they don't serve us well, so there is some demolition in this. But in total, we will be adding construction of 4,600 beds to bring us to a total of a little over 7,000 beds on the campus, which will achieve that housing objective. When you heard the president say we've got 5,000 and a demand of about 2,000 more, then we are within our market parameters of the demand for housing. The way we're doing that is building out these existing housing areas. The quad here, we're adding some additional housing down 49th. Two buildings that have about 380 beds each. Behind the baseball stadium, some housing of about 500 beds. I'll talk more about this, but the stadium area, as we look at a new stadium facility, how do we repurpose that? The stadium, existing stadium, is a perfect opportunity for the university to create a new residential community. It is close to the academic core. It has existing some recreational area that's called the playing field. The Ainsley building can easily be converted to support some food service operations, some retail operations, study space, and something we've never had on this campus, and that is support for our Greek organizations, because it turns out the suites are a perfect size for chapter rooms. We do not have the space on this campus for a traditional Greek row, and there is nowhere in this plan to do that. But to recognize those organizations, we can repurpose that investment to create the chapter rooms that is popular at many institutions. So then in the village, when they were laid out, we didn't anticipate being as residential as we are. So those infill parking areas, we will infill those with structured parking and housing on top of it, just bringing more efficiency to the area. So once we can put them in a classroom, we have a bed for them, we need to do things like feed them. We've done a pretty exhaustive study of food service. Much like when the president got here in the mid-90s, I got here in the mid-80s, and we had 2,100 beds, about 15,000 students. The food service presence on this campus today is basically the same that was there in 85. So we need to bring that current. We are using the concept of creating residential communities where you live in this area. We're bringing food into it and recreation into that community. So in the quad, as we build out the housing to create the massing there, we will start, this project is under design, and we will actually start construction on it in February timeframe. The first freestanding residential dining hall in the campus's history. Most residential campuses have that, we never have. It will be special. I look forward to inviting you there for a meal. This will seat about 600. When we rebuild Webb, we will build in about 700 seats of additional dining, residential dining, and 250 to 300 seats of retail dining. I've explained about how we convert the Ainsley building to serve that residential community. And then in the village, we will move the bookstore back into the Union when that's reconstructed, convert that property into dining and recreation to support the University Village community. Administrative facilities, we do have a need for that on campus. The two most significant things that are in this plan is this building. Our Student Success Center is very popular, but that popularity is putting demands on the building that are beyond its ability to support. Plus, the definition of a Student Success Center has grown over time in programmatic definition. So we will be building basically where we're sitting right now, an additional building on 49th Street that will become a combined student enrollment services and student success building, and locating it next to the Union. One of the things we are really, really good at Old Dominion University is hiding our admissions office. we're really good there.
Yeah, you are.
That needs to be fixed. So we're going to bring that right out here front and center, close to parking and the like.
Dave, your bookstore and moving it back on campus, in a sense, for alumni who like to shop at the current bookstore and spend money on campus, it's fairly convenient. Now, even though there's not a lot of parking spots next to it, there are parking garages that I can park at, walk out, and go spend $70 on a shirt, because that's usually how much it costs. Now you're putting it back in the campus. Where am I going to park?
I said bookstore.
Okay.
I didn't say we were going to eliminate your ability to spend your money with us.
I don't want to do it online. I want to.
I didn't say that either.
Okay. All right.
This is really not an issue of the master plan so much as it is a programmatic plan, but we're working on a new retail services plan for the institution. You will have more opportunity to spend your money with us in the future.
Okay.
We love doing that. I mean, I liked collecting your tuition back in the day.
Sure.
I don't want to miss that opportunity now. So. So that building is significant, and then this building is very significant. Cook Hall, which supports the president's office and many of the VP offices, is a very old building. It's totally inadequate, probably not adequate the day it was built. And because we have the TED and the new education building, we really think this is the front door to the university in the future. And so we will build a new administrative support building there, but the first floor will contain things like learning commons and space for students that support this residential community. I'm almost through, Mayor. Recreation, we have to bring that into the mix. You may notice that Rogers and Gresham kind of don't exist in this display anymore. I hope that doesn't upset anyone, but if you look at flooding and sea level rise, which is important to all of us. We don't have to have sea level to get flooding around those buildings. They kind of are a problem. And they were the original residence halls of the institution, have never been brought current. So they're really not much of an investment. Plus, we can create outdoor recreation to support the village and also support tailgating for athletic events so that we're keeping those kinds of activities along Hampton Boulevard and not infiltrating the campus with that so much. I've mentioned Foreman Field. We'll also do a few things like convert some space in the quad to recreation and support of the students. Now, athletics. The primary part of athletics, and from a land consumption standpoint, is in the southwest corner of the campus. The TED certainly does support athletics. And many of you may not know this, but there are people that measure everything. And for the folks that measure performance of arenas, they do it by size. The TED, in the years that it's been in operation, has every year been in the top 10 revenue-producing facilities in the world for an arena its size. And one year was the number one revenue-producing arena in the world. The TED has been, I think, a very productive and important benefit to the campus and the city. We are currently designing an addition to that building to move our basketball practice facilities and coaches' offices next to the TED. Most significantly here is the expansion of LR Hill. This is not a statement that commits us to doing this, but when we were doing the master plan, we were asked if the university started a softball program, can we put that on campus? The answer to that, in my opinion, is yes. That is shown here. That is currently located where our plant operations are, which we would move off campus. You see this symbol. I will speak in more detail in a moment, but quite honestly, if you look at the size of this, the only available contiguous land within the institution's boundaries to handle a new stadium is over the Powhatan Apartments. There is literally no other option in how you place that facility. So I'll speak more detail about that in just a second. We do need some specialized facilities on the campus, such as a meeting space, a university conference center in support of the university programs. I've mentioned a web center, and so we would kind of distribute those throughout the institution where they make sense. From a transportation and parking standpoint, we examined that and the growth rate we would need to support this program. And depicted here in what you see shown as additional parking spaces in the salmon color allows us to add about 3,600 parking spaces to the campus, all structured parking.
David, what's the gray rectangle to the north of what would be the new athletic football field?
This area here,
yes, sir.
And here. In the 1995 master plan, that was included as potential expansion areas of the campus, and we are preserving that. There is no intent to go acquire that land now, but if it's not in our master plan, and we could not acquire it, and so if there is a market opportunity in those areas, we would consider it over time. But no intent to aggressively pursue those properties. Now this is a pretty important to us as we've become more residential with the interaction of the University Village and the campus. Moving people across Hampton Boulevard is a challenge. Our students, for some reason, think their skin is tougher than the metal and the plastic in the vehicles, and sometimes they're not very attentive.
Well, especially when they're on their skateboard.
Yeah, so sometimes they're not very attentive to the traffic signals. So we need to create a controlled way of moving people across Hampton Boulevard that is more controlled than what we have. There's lots of studies that show that pedestrian bridges are really not that effective. But we will look at that in the future. But more importantly, we have the east-west pedestrian spine that we are proposing to create a grade-based tram system with a controlled crossing at Hampton Boulevard. We have positioned this to take advantage of what we perceive the potential routes of intersection with light rail in the future. From a campus standpoint, it's either Kellam, Hampton, or Powhatan. And so if we can create a transfer depot off a light rail into the campus transportation system, that's at least the level of planning we can do now until we understand those routes better.
Dave, what about maglev? What are your plans for that?
Well, the maglev actually is a research project. The people in the College of Engineering are doing research.
Presently?
I'm sorry?
Now?
Yes. And I mean, they can make the sled move and start and stop and control it. And if you would sign a liability waiver, they may even let you ride it. So you know, I will say to you the infrastructure that is that total infrastructure, when we do the grade-based transportation, we convert that infrastructure to support all of the lighting and all of the things that go along with creating that transportation corridor. So we would use that to install infrastructure in support of transportation.
The one thing I would mention is or John had mentioned it, about knowing where the campus is. And perhaps since you do have, once you get that, I guess the footprint as you see it and the buildings begin to go up, but distinctive signs on each end of Hampton Boulevard not only help you, but help the city.
Well, there is a real opportunity for us to partner. I'm probably sensitive to this more than you are, but if I start approaching the city of Norfolk coming from 264, there are no signs saying where Old Dominion is. If I come out of 464, there are no signs. There is one little bitty sign in the downtown area kind of pointing towards Old Dominion. If I'm coming from Terminal Boulevard, it says OD University. I don't know where that is. Thank you for mentioning
we need to
that.
Make that.
I will
happen.
Put that on my list to speak with the city manager that we need to increase that signage of saying where Old Dominion University is located.
And it's a problem with all of our universities. Here, there is no distinctive signage to say here you are at this wonderful university.
Right.
Yeah. And we do have to do some work in really implementing, I think, a more robust signage program.
Yeah.
You've got to look at the campus in some degree kind of like an airport. I mean, I need vehicular level so that gets people where they need to be on the campus, get them out of their car, then move them around. So we do have some work to do there.
Dave, I don't think there's an issue there. I mean, if you have a sign package.
There's no problem.
Okay.
I mean, it's a issue we've never tackled, and it's time to do
that. Well, let's do it together.
Yeah.
That was my point. I was, you know, just picking a little bit.
You may
now, when we do what I've described to this campus, it's done.
We won't recognize it.
There is, sorry?
We won't recognize it.
Well, but even more than that, you have to understand that as long as the parameters stay the same and availability to land for us, we're done. That's the end. So we have to look then what happens. The president mentioned our higher ed centers. One is in the city of Virginia Beach. We own a footprint as shown here. There is one building of about 80,000 square feet there. And looking at that land, we can easily add minimally to that location about 200,000 square feet of building. Someday, when this campus is fully built out and the university has programmatic needs and we have nowhere to go, we will have to consider dispersing the institution. There will be no choice. So we have the ability there. And at our Tri-City Center, actually located, this is the Virginia Modeling Simulation Center located in Suffolk and the Tri-City Center located in Portsmouth. But this is fairly built out, so we don't see much opportunity to expand that footprint. So I'm sure none of you are interested in this, so I'll just skip over and go to questions. So here's the deal. Regardless of what you've read or what you think you've been told about our plans for the stadium, you have to forget all of that. We have not declared the size of the stadium. We have not declared how the stadium would fit into the campus. We only know a location that can be suitable for a new stadium. As it turns out, Foreman Field was built in the 30s as a WPA project. And in the 30s, the building codes were a little bit different than they are today. Okay? So as long as we don't touch the structure, and when we started football, we used a lot of care not to touch the structure. We added the suites, for example, in the Ainsley building, because if we touch it, we've got to bring the building to code. Just, for example, one item. To bring that building to code, we would have to do this. 38 sinks and 138 water closets to the building just to meet that code. You can't do that to that structure without having to demolish it.
What are vomitories?
I don't even want to know.
I leave that there because someone always asks that question.
I have an idea of what one is. But
the big openings where you walk up the ramp into the stadium, that's called a vomitory.
It really goes
back to old Roman stadiums, so you can draw your own conclusions.
So it had nothing to do with
anything else.
Well, it might in the older days. So if you assess that site, what we know is that in a modern stadium, there's only an adequate footprint to support 25,000 seats there. Okay? So now that gives us parameters to understand what our ability is based on location. Now, as I said, the only place that can go above 25,000 seats is this location. But we still don't know how big it should be. All right? So the plan is to do exactly what we did with the TED. When we built the TED, the original plan was to build it at 10,000 seats. But we learned, because we did a market seating demand study, fan preference, we looked at marketability and all of those things, that 10,000 seats was not the right number. It actually turned out, and that's why we built a facility with 8,600 seats and then used additional funds to bring the quality of the building up, the fan amenities up. And that building is now 12 years old and standing the test of time very well. It actually has become the design basis for three other arenas in the United States, including the new arena at Auburn University. So it's a very successful project. We need to do the same thing with this facility, because we don't know the answers to those questions yet. It would make no sense to build a stadium that people would have to leave home on Tuesday to get here because the road network can't support the traffic. So we don't know the answers to that at this point. Later this month, we will release the bid document to select the planners to assist the university in understanding all of those data so that we can declare what we believe is an appropriate size for the stadium, how it should be configured. We will be engaging the city and the neighborhoods to talk about traffic management and parking and how we make this facility work in this larger community. There's certainly a lot of assumptions about what we're going to do, but the bottom line is until we conduct this study and understand those data and interact about the project, all of that is pure speculation at this point.
Dave, did you say later this month you'll be issuing your bids?
Yes, we'll start the process of procuring the services.
Okay.
So at that point, we had a proposed master plan and we went through a validation process. I made about 43 public presentations on this master plan, taking input from people. The input that really influenced the changes to the plan, we needed to add an additional building to support the College of Arts and Letters, and we can do that here. We need to allow for future expansion of the College of Health Sciences, so we reconfigured this and also reconfigured this so that we made up for the lost opportunity to expand engineering. And we at one time had a plan to move the Alumni House function here into this area of 49th Street. We think it better fits along in this community where a potential meeting center is that allows us to do some waterfront development to bring community and university amenities to bear in that area of the campus. So those amendments help us end up with the new master plan of the campus as adopted by the board and as represented here. So you can see from this graphic, this becomes a fairly built out campus, but in my view, it is well organized. It has good flow. It has good relationship programmatically within the institution. So what we accomplished in this is we have the ability to add 875,000 square feet of E&G space, about 374,000 square feet of auxiliary space, new athletic facilities, new residence hall facilities. We've added dining and parking and recreation, and we've got a modern campus to support us as we move forward in the future. Other than that, there was not much more that we thought of.
Dave, how are you going to pay for it?
But that's another one of those partnering opportunities with the state. The way I described at the beginning of the presentation, the E&G buildings become part of the university's capital program with the state. And then the auxiliary buildings, we plan for the debt service to support that out of university revenue. So your next question might be, well, how long? And the way I look at campus master plans is not time. The master plan becomes the vision for the campus. The capital program becomes its execution. And so the capital program is certainly dependent on the Commonwealth's appetite to support E&G buildings, and the auxiliary buildings are based on our ability of paying the debt service within our existing debt management structure of the university. But when we started the University Village, the same questions, and no, it can't ever happen, and it won't work. It did. If you can't perceive what you need to do in the future, it surely will never happen. And that's what this is about.
And there's a logical progression as we get the School of Ed going, that the next facility for us that's significant is a life sciences building. We're now second in Virginia in terms of producing STEM age graduates, but we have to dramatically elevate our lab facilities if we're going to continue to recruit and attract those types of students. So, I mean, there's a significant plan, and obviously not all these things are going to happen at once, not all these things are going to happen in the next 5 years, but as David said, it's an aspiration, and for an institution that's it's pretty much landlocked. You know, we have to have a pretty clear understanding of what we're going to need and where we're going to go forward. And then obviously, as the science building gets taken care of, then the next significant step for us is an improvement of our health sciences facility. So it's gradual, but we feel that we have to lay it out in order for our campus and all of us to understand where we're going.
Do you have a guesstimate on a timeline? For instance, your expectations?
If I put it in perspective of the University Village, if you take into consideration the plan for the village was done in about 94, 95, and you know, look at it now. So it's hard for me to really predict that with any specificity because it is so contingent on the capital program of the Commonwealth. But generally, most master plans kind of have a 20 to 25 year horizon to them because in that time frame, things change that you may need to relook at what you do. So we don't think much more in advance of 20 to 25 years.
With the consideration on the stadium, and refresh me on this, how much of this is mandated by the new league?
None.
So are there time constraints that you're mandated to increase the number of seats?
No. The stadium that we have meets the seating requirements. In fact, the new conference rules are not about seating capacity, they're about attendance. But it's more about demand and modernization of the stadium and fan amenities and safety. I mean, the stadium as it currently sits and meeting ADA requirements, it just doesn't. And you can't make them. If we tried to do ADA in that stadium, we'd probably lose a third of the seats. I mean, it's a great building for when it was built, but it just programmatically does not support our needs.
So we have to look in that. I didn't understand what you said. What would be the plan for Foreman Field or the new stadium?
Foreman Field itself would be preserved and become recreational facilities for the housing development around Foreman Field. And all of that housing would be focused back towards Foreman Field, not out to the neighborhood.
Right. Okay. And what would happen with the old academic buildings that are there along Hampton?
We preserve those. Those are our history there. I would never, never in a million years talk about those going away. Cook Hall would have to be removed, but not Spong, Hall.
Cook Hall is where the president's office is.
Yeah, it's one on stilts.
Yeah.
That needs to go.
Yeah, it's a challenge. But we have really tried in this plan to, and one of the principles I always try to incorporate into a campus master plan, the university really should be able to pursue its future. You have the responsibility of trying and doing that in a respectful way of the community in which we exist. But we have to pursue our future. And we've tried very hard to do that in this plan. We're not invading the neighborhood for land acquisition any further. We are building parking to address that issue. We are building housing to address that issue. And we have committed to engage the surrounding communities in our planning efforts, and we will do that.
I think you both are aware that the Larchmont Civic League has asked for a long-range plan, and obviously that's a very expensive proposal. And I hope we can continue to work in just like this, with this dialogue, so that the community can understand the impact on
the
increased enrollment and parking. You know, you and I have been working on this for a number of years, so I hope that'll continue.
We made that commitment in the presentation we made to them, and we will fulfill it. I think we do have to understand that the university at some point really is going to have to address the issue, and we try to do it in a respectful, meaningful way to the neighborhood, but There again, for some of the issues like parking and traffic management, that really is going to be a place where we need to work closely with the city. So when we do this study, not only will we engage the community, we will heavily engage the city as it relates to how we do traffic management and that planning. It's not something we just can do alone and just do it. I mean, that's not our intent. So in my view, a lot of the concerns that I've heard expressed are based on people assuming things that are not accurate. Like the size of the stadium.
Welcome to our world. Welcome to our world.
I was pleased that, you know, two of our major issues for traffic are Powhatan and Hampton, obviously. And with this plan, it would appear that most of the housing would not be west of Powhatan. Am I correct?
Exactly.
Which is now one of the major issues of safety. And some of that would be relieved with your plans on Hampton. But.
Right. We actually are, in our view, really consolidating the campus in a way that we're minimizing the traffic that moves back to the western corridor of the campus on a regular daily basis. And programmatically moving things there that have occasional use. It may, and the stadium is 6 days a year, you know? So I guess from, I'm probably biased, but I think the plan actually enhances the position of the university within the broader community rather than the opposite.
Dave, quite important traffic management issue. It's a large project which has been on the region's radar for years. It's something called Patriots Crossing.
Right.
You know, in probably less than 3 years, we'll have a new Midtown tunnel that should flush more traffic through Hampton Boulevard, and that includes a lot of Old Dominion students, staff, as well as, you know, folks from NOB and from the Naval Base and trucks. I mean, the whole thing, that should help. The 564 intermodal connector, which will go under construction hopefully next month, and about a 2 or 3 year build out, should help as well and take some of these containers off Hampton Boulevard.
Right.
Because there will be gates built right from the expanded North Gate. Will help there as well as a new gate at the Naval Base. But the Patriots Crossing is the piece that should have gone first, you know, because of a lot of things that is now going behind the Midtown Tunnel second. But that is something that if John, if you think well of, maybe we could make a presentation to your board or whoever here, because we would enjoy, that project needs a lot of community support.
Is the Patriots Crossing.
Patriots Crossing, you know, it's leaves off of just north of NIT,
right,
just south of the Naval Base, and goes over to the modern Merrimack, and that would help relieve congestion at the Midtown Tunnel, the Downtown Tunnel, but even more so at the Bridge Tunnel. But the big winner there is Hampton Boulevard.
Yeah. So, as I recall, as far back as like the mid to late 90s when that first concept first started.
93, 94 is
right, and we had all those committees. You know, the university was certainly supportive of that strategy then. And I don't see anything that would change our opinion. It's probably what has changed would strengthen our resolve to support that happening. You know, some of the problems that, you know, we face are not necessarily the amount of traffic on Hampton Boulevard, is sometimes the kind of traffic, and, you know, young people and their behavior, you know, of really not paying attention to a truck coming. All of those, as we look at this community, I mean, Hampton Boulevard is a challenge to improve, and we all know that. So that set of strategies, I think, are much like how we've done the campus master plan. You have to look at a toolkit of strategies that go to help resolve that, and those are certainly two
ways of doing that.
The voice of Old Dominion would be very helpful.
Yeah, we'd be glad. And I think, and you too, going back maybe to what Andy said, is you continue to look at where you're going to invest in light rail. I've never lived in any market where light rail doesn't go to destinations. And with 25,000 students and over 3,500 employees and more than 500,000 people who come here on an annual basis for events, I certainly think, you know, we check every box in that category. So I you know, will continue to make a pitch to Paul and anyone in the room publicly or privately that if you're really looking at places that are going to increase traffic, and those places are typically in any market I've lived in, places where there's a significant destination, I hope, you know, we're in that plan going forward too.
Absolutely. Okay. Any other questions?
That was terrific.
Yeah, this was a great discussion and dialogue. Thank you for the information, the presentation. You know, and we appreciate you all taking the time to be so kind.
Thank you for coming.
That's great.
So, do we want to do the tour? Is everyone still interested in the tour, or?